In the Communication Sciences and Disorders program here at James Madison University, we have a vision, and our vision was developed by our faculty. And our consensus was that we want to bridge science and clinical practice. What this means is that we want our students to understand the science that underlies what they're hoping to practice in, and that this will drive them to be able to make good decisions, to be problem solvers as they face a child in the school environment, as they face a stroke patient that's in a rehab facility. So we want them to be able to be good thinkers.
Communication Sciences and Disorders is various disorders and diseases that can contribute to communication deficits.
So that would cover speaking, listening, reading, writing, hearing, swallowing, from infancy all the way up into late life issues.
It is in preparation for students who want to pursue either speech-language pathology or audiology. Freshman year, you start with the introductory course, and then you actually don't start your major classes until spring of sophomore year. And you're in three prerequisite classes, which determine your continuation throughout the rest of the program. And then from there, you move up through all of the courses.
Our students have a methods class where they're able to be in the clinic. They are paired with a graduate student. And so the students, before they leave here with the bachelor's degree, they have done some hands-on time in the clinic, and they really know what to expect, and they're prepared as they move into the graduate programs.
We're big enough that we have lots of opportunities for students, but we're small enough that students can still feel like individuals and have some individual faculty relationships, and they're not just a number. There's still opportunities to make those more intimate connections.
We do tend to have very big classes, but the faculty members are dedicated to creating additional opportunities to be more engaged with individual students.
Lots of students get involved with faculty research. I typically have at least four or five students every semester that would like to help with teaching some of the larger classes. Most of our faculty take on an honors student and supervise honors projects. So there are some opportunities for the students to get to know faculty more in a smaller setting.
I think as faculty members, we try to foster a connection with the students. So hopefully that is something that comes through, even though we do tend to have big classes.
I think that the biggest thing that compensates for it is the expertise of the faculty. They're all very well versed in the field and in the ongoing research that surrounds it. Because of their expertise, they can provide such an effective and efficient learning environment that I think that it compensates for the larger class sizes that we have.
They're great. They really show you that they want you to succeed and that they want us to do the best that we can. You can really feel that they're here for us to do well.
I think it's really important that, you know, one of our roles as a faculty member is we're preparing the next generation of clinicians. And so our clients and our students deserve excellent teachers, and JMU highly values excellence in teaching. After the undergraduate program, typically our students are going to follow one of two paths. They're both the clinical route. It's determined on whether they want to be a speech-language pathologist or an audiologist. So in either case, they go to graduate school.
I feel extremely prepared. You know, our classes are very rigorous, but I feel like it's a really good foundation for what we're going to be doing in the future.
Our students tend to go beyond Virginia often for their graduate degrees, and we're always pleased when we go to conferences or meet our friends at meetings at ASHA, and they say, oh, we love your students from JMU. They're always so well prepared. So we're very proud of that, and always very proud of the students that we have in our program.